Tonight, Columbia honors Mark Mazower, the Ira D. Wallach Professor of World Order Studies and Chair of our History Department. In just a few moments, Professor Mazower will become the latest in a long and distinguished line of Columbia faculty to deliver the university lecture. The university lecture is one of our most edifying as well as enjoyable traditions. It is now entering its fifth decade. The first of these lectures, titled Mind in the Modern World, was delivered by Lionel Trilling. In the years since Trilling's inaugural address, the university community has been treated to presentations on subjects ranging from Herman Melville and the human condition to cellular biology of the HIV virus, a spectrum as broad and encompassing as the remarkable range of scholarship found at this institution. Last year, we heard from Mailman School Dean Linda Freed on the social consequences of an aging population, and from Professor George Lewis about the value of improvisation beyond the artistic and musical domains. A significant part of the ambition of the university lecture is simply to counter the perhaps natural centrifugal forces within academic life. On these special nights, Columbia's faculty and students set aside what is often, by necessity, our solitary and single-minded dedication to our discipline, our subjects, and make time to hear from some of our most accomplished colleagues. Without fail, we depart from low, library richer for the experience. Professor Mazower's topic tonight is Governing the World, the Rise and Fall of an Idea. It is without question a timely subject. The increasing interconnectedness of societies around the world presents us with an abundance of dramatic events of global import. Development in faraway nations have as much and often more significance for our own future than events taking place closer to home sometimes do. Since the start of this year, we have witnessed popular youth-led democracy movements stretching from Egypt to Chile. We have monitored China's continuing ascendancy on the world stage with all its promise and provocation. And now we receive daily bulletins on the financial crisis in Europe and the fate of the Occupy movement from cities around the nation. Our special role in universities is as much as possible to locate events in the larger sweep of human affairs, to supply perspective and deeper understanding. Without doubt, our public discourse neglects this dimension at its serious risk. The scholarship of Professor Mazower is a prime example of what we uniquely have to offer. One of the contemporary issues brought into sharper relief by Professor Mazower's work and tonight's talk is the question of the continued potential and potency of international law. This is, of course, extremely important. After all, without law, what else do we have? And shortly you will hear Professor Mazower's nuanced analysis of this question and several related issues. Professor Mazower's life's journey has taken him from North London to Northern Manhattan, from Oxford, Johns Hopkins, and Princeton to Columbia, and from his youthful interest in the classics to his current status as one of our preeminent historians of modern Greece and 20th century Europe. We are pleased that he has made each of these choices and that his path has led him exactly to where he is tonight, Chair of Columbia's Distinguished Department of History and our Fall 2011 University Lecturer. To formally introduce Professor Mazower, please welcome John Coatsworth, the Dean of the School of International and Public Affairs and our Interim University Provost. Thank you.
Thank you, Lee, and good evening to all of you. Before I introduce the speaker, I have two confessions to make. The first is, Mark Mazower is my department chair, so the probability that you're going to hear something offensive from me in the next few minutes is rather diminished. But as department chairs go, and I'm a former department chair myself and rather a connoisseur of them, Mark Mazower is a genius. So I'm delighted to be a member of the history department, as well as interim provost and a dean at SIPA. The second confession I want to make is that some years ago, I was part of a nefarious plot to lure Mark Mazower from Columbia to Harvard. And like many of the failures in my life, I've learned to appreciate this one, having moved myself to Columbia and found him here. As President Bollinger said, Professor Mazower is a widely acclaimed scholar of modern Greece, 20th century Europe, and international history. His prolific research and writing over the past two decades has produced many important volumes, including a book on the history of the Balkans, several books enriching our understanding of Greece during and after World War II, and the award-winning Hitler's Empire, Nazi Rule in Occupied Europe, published in 2008. His most recent work, No Enchanted Palace, The End of Empire and the Ideological Origins of the United Nations, has been widely praised as a rare and valuable corrective to the received wisdom about the birth of the United Nations and the animating goals of the UN's founding nations, a book that simultaneously offers an historical reappraisal and informs current debates. No Enchanted Palace provides a compelling point of departure for Professor Mazower's current work on the history of internationalism, and indeed for the subject of his lecture this evening, Governing the World, the Rise and Fall of an Idea. As someone who shares with Professor Mazower a professional interest in international history and the experience of studying a discrete region of the world, I am, of course, very much looking forward to the thoughts he will be sharing with us tonight. One of the things made manifest by Professor Mazower's work is that international history is a powerful, and I would argue an indispensable tool for properly understanding contemporary world events. Never has that been more true than today. To take one example, Professor Mazower's commentary on Greece's financial crisis has insisted we look beyond the urgent and very real worries about the immediate consequences of a potential Greek default to consider larger tensions between the imperatives of modern financial markets and the necessary conditions for democracy, tensions that have been revealed in new and dramatic ways by the financial problems confronting the European Union. Professor Mazower received his undergraduate degree in classics at Harvard, at Oxford, earned a master's in international relations at Johns Hopkins University, and has a doctorate in modern history, also from Oxford. He has taught at the University of London, the University of Sussex, and Princeton University, and he's a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Professor Mazower's writing on history and current affairs appears regularly in newspapers and journals published here and in England. Most importantly for all of us assembled here tonight, he is today Columbia's Ira D. Wallach Professor of World Order Studies, the chair of our history department, and the director of Columbia's Center for International History. In addition to being celebrated tonight as the university lecturer, Professor Mazower recently was honored with the annual Great Teachers Award given by the Society of Columbia Graduates. Please welcome Professor Mark Mazower.
I'd like to thank President Bollinger and Dean Coatsworth for those very generous words of introduction, and all of you for coming along this evening and allowing me to inflict some of my ideas on you. I started to get interested in this subject in the 1990s during the war in Yugoslavia, and particularly during the dismemberment of Bosnia, which was an episode I felt very strongly about, and which didn't cover the UN in much glory. And that got me to thinking about the longer run history of the United Nations. And then coming to Colombia in the aftermath of the invasion of Iraq, at a time when the Bush administration had put the UN in the limelight, one could not help but continue to be interested in this question of what the UN was for. I felt in some kind of inarticulate way that I was in favor of the UN, but I couldn't really tell you why I was in favor of the UN very easily. So this is a story that for me predates Colombia, but it's also very much a Colombia story. And it's a Colombia story in a double sense, in that as I've realized as I work through this, by virtue of being in New York, Colombia and Colombia personalities, and I'm thinking of people like Nicholas Murray Butler, the president in the interwar period, or Andrew Cordier in the 1970s, were in fact very important parts of this story. What is this story? Well, I have a 350-page manuscript that I wrote before I worked out what my argument was, but I felt for this evening I should try and find one. So what I'm doing is experimenting with an argument on you, and I shall be very interested in your reactions. The basic presupposition is that the UN itself is not really what matters here, that you have to see the story of the UN as part of something very much broader, and that is the idea of international government per se, that you have to then situate in its period and its time frame. And this time frame, in my opinion, corresponds roughly to the era of Anglo-American hegemony in world affairs, that is to say, from the early 19th century until the late 20th. And I suppose one of the questions that my interpretation raises that we may want to think about at the end is whether we are now moving into a new kind of era in world politics, and if so, what sort of effect this will have on the future of the idea or the ideas of governing the world that I'm going to outline. So I'm going to tell a relatively simple story that covers only 200 years, and I'm going to focus on three turning points that I think were of particular significance. The first is 1815 and the aftermath of Napoleon's defeat in Europe and the rise of the idea in Europe of international government. The second is the end of the First World War and the founding of the League of Nations, which I see as the moment of the realization of this idea globally and the instauration of a kind of Anglo-American hegemony. And the third is 1975, or more precisely from 1975 until now, which I see as the period of disintegration and the erosion of international institutions at the same time as the international economy globalizes. And the question then is, for us now, is what is the connection between these things? So, 1815, the 19th century, the rise of the idea of international government. In 1815, when Napoleon was defeated, the victors came together, determined to continue the alliance that had brought him down into the peace, and they created a system of regular conference that became known as the Concert of Europe. One of the architects of this, Metternich's right-hand man, a very brilliant analyst called Friedrich von Gentz, was quite clear in his own mind what this was. It was, as he wrote, a phenomenon without precedent in the world's history. That is to say, not that there had not been in the past visions of cosmic harmony, of mankind coming together, of toppling monarchs. We can trace those back to the Bible and even earlier. But an institutionalized system of great power cooperation to regulate the peace and speak in the name of, in this case, Europe, later it would be the world, had opened a new chapter in the history of international affairs. So the Concert of Europe, you might say, was the first model of international governance. And it was, but in some ways it was also an anti-model. The Concert of Europe was established mostly by emperors, together with the monarchy in Britain, and later, of course, the French, now safely under a monarchy, would be allowed in, to preserve what they could of the status quo, to restore the rights of monarchs and bring them back on their thrones, to suppress what Castlereagh called the revolutionary embers, to stamp out signs of democratic reform and demands for constitutionalism. And it was in the criticism that this complex of motives elicited from 1815 onwards through the first half of the century, that we can see the emergence of those ideas of international government that are going to become powerful and formative in the 20th century. So the 19th century operates as the incubator of radical critiques of the concept of Europe. Two ways. Firstly, territorially. One of the things that happens in the aftermath of Napoleon's defeat is the Western Hemisphere achieves a kind of self-consciousness ideologically as a zone of internationalism that can pit itself against the bad old diplomacy of the concert of Europe the old continent itself. The Western Hemisphere becomes a kind of alternative governance space. You might see the Monroe Doctrine of 1823 as the precondition for that, but actually its intellectuals, John Coatsworth will know this better than me, in the new republics of South America that articulate this idea just as much as the North Americans do. That is to say, the ideology of Americanism, the ideology of institutionalized international cooperation through the 19th century by democratic republican states, offers this kind of alter ego version of the concert of Europe. And it does so in a very self-conscious way. They see themselves as distinctive not only because of their democratic character, but also because they can experiment with new kinds of ways of running affairs between states. Arbitration would be one case in point. The codification of international law would be another, well in advance of anything that's happening in Europe. So there's a territorial dimension to this in the 19th century, and there's a huge ideological critique that's happening mostly within Europe, but spilling over across the Atlantic as well. And it's this ideological critique that I want to just classify very, very briefly. There's a huge range of critics of the concert of Europe through the 19th century. But I think we can distinguish two phases of criticism and two kinds of criticism. The first is what you might call the evangelical Christian golden age idea, the age of radical peace movements. There's Elihu Burritt, the so-called learned blacksmith from New Britain in Massachusetts, who was supposed to be able to speak 17 languages and who was an immense mobilizer of peace conferences in Europe, in Britain chiefly, in the 1830s and especially in the 1840s. But also the era of radicals in free trade as well, much more respectable men like Richard Cobden. And they would have their role to play in the 20th century as well. And you can see the continuation of the free trade movement as a movement of internationalism and a movement of world peace running right through more or less seamlessly from Cobden to the Tennessee Cobden, as he was called, Cordell Hull, Roosevelt's Secretary of State in the 1930s and 1940s, who sees himself in 1945 finally in the position to carry out for the world the Cobdenite manifesto of world peace. Equally radical, equally influential in the 20th century, the revolutionary nationalist criticism of the autocrats of the concert. Above all, the Italian Giuseppe Mazzini, who's imprisoned by the Austrians, and when he's released from prison, goes abroad into exile and begins this very, very effective propaganda in favor of a banding together of Europe's oppressed nationalities against the autocrats of Europe. Why? Because in his conception, the cause isn't just his own cause, that's to say the cause of Italian national independence. It's the cause of peace in Europe. That peace will only come in Europe when every people is free, when the Poles are free and the Hungarians are free, because war is fomented by aristocrats and autocrats and by closed government and secret diplomacy. And Mazzini is just as influential as Cobden in the 20th century. Who does Woodrow Wilson go and pay his respects to on a rainy day in Genoa in 1919 on his way to the Paris Peace Conference? To the Mazzini Monument. And there he says to the Italians gathered, "I feel I'm taking part in accomplishing the realization of the ideals to which his, Mazzini's, life and thought were devoted." So Wilson is perfectly clear about this. If you think of world government and world peace coming together not through a single world government from above and not through some mystical merging of peoples, but through a society of nations, Mazzini is your man. Mazzini is the man who has made this particular vision possible. And I would say that the Wilsonian idea, which I shall say more about, and the whole principle upon which the League of Nations is structured and then the United Nations are structured are essentially Mazzinian. And then there's the third form of utopian internationalism that is going to pit itself against the Mazzinian in the 20th century, and that is, of course, that internationalism that I grew up with thinking as the only true internationalism, that's to say socialist internationalism, the internationalism of Karl Marx. As I say, when I grew up and you talked about internationalism, I assumed you were talking about the first, second, or third, or maybe fourth international. You're talking about the left, and you're talking about worker power. But in fact, we can now see that Marx and the whole idea of worker internationalism is just one part of this much larger landscape of internationalist thinking of the middle of the 19th century. But not to belabor the point, it will be Marx and the Marxian version of internationalism that will influence the second major superpower of the 20th century, the Soviet Union, and turn the Cold War into a competition ideologically between two rival 19th century visions of internationalism. Well, that's all very well for the future, and I think the future does play itself out like that, but it doesn't work out very well in the late 19th century, when in fact people do not listen to Mazzini and people do not listen to Marx, as we know. And instead, internationalists deduce from the relative failures of these utopian projects that you need to be more practical in thinking about world affairs. You need to think about incremental, positive, administration-friendly steps towards improving international understanding. You need to compromise with power and compromise with government. And here's where we get the thinking about government. And so I would see the second half of the 19th century as the moment, you might call it the professional moment, the moment of ideas about governments and organization in which statisticians and public health experts and people interested in things like posts and canals and communications start positing international collaboration as their role to world peace. The great central current in this is the current of science and engineering and the notion of a scientific organization of society, that if you only you can wrest power away from those meddlesome politicians and put it in the hands of people who actually know something, usually about numbers, then you've made an important step towards the cause of world peace. And this notion that a scientific language would provide the basis for achieving what for them is, of course, already there in spirit, that is to say, the unity of mankind, it could be found in geography. The great anarchist geographers like Pyotr Kropotkin believe you simply need to know, to visualize all the peoples of the world, to come to the understanding of what you share in common. The Frenchman, the equally important anarchist, half the important geographers in the 19th century seem to be anarchists. Elisée Reclus, who has this vision that is only now being constructed in the Arizona desert, of constructing a great globe of the world for the same reason, that if you construct this and you see this, you will simply see how much all humanity shares. We think of H.G. Wells, and from Wells and people like that, you get a different idea of world government. A lot of the scientists are drawn to the idea of a single unitary world government, which is the option, of course, that fails in the 20th century. But you also have the new notion of a universal language per se, Esperanto. The idea that you find a single language, miscommunication will drop away, except that as if any of you know who've ever looked into the history of Esperanto, what happens is that the exponents of Esperanto immediately start quarreling with the exponents of Volapük and the exponents of Edo, and later on there will be the exponents of Interlingua, and before you know it, you have a mini world war amongst the universal linguists. And more important perhaps than them, because more influential, the rise of the professional international lawyer, what the historian Martti Koskenniemi has called the men of 1871, the men who believe that now is the time where if you codify and standardize international law, you create world courts, you put the lawyers in the position to check the autocrats and the militarists, world peace will come in that way. It's a vision of government in which diplomacy and aggressive impulses are tamed by the sanity of the law. And it's perhaps the predominant vein of internationalism amongst influential elites in the United States, and for that matter in Russia, at the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th. So all these ideas are in the air in the 19th century, and there's some institutional incarnation of them, but on the whole, there's very limited governmental buy-in, and there's certainly no overarching organization. And so the question for me becomes, how do we explain out of the First World War organization? How do we explain the realization and the institutionalization of these ideas? How do you get from the learned blacksmith to Woodrow Wilson? The most powerful man in the world in 1919 is now an internationalist. And the short answer is that internationalism becomes great power strategy, which it had not been before, and it becomes great power strategy because the two powers that had effectively won the war, the British and the Americans, define their strategic needs in those terms. Let me go further. It's not really the Americans in 1919 who do that, although that's now the popular mythology that all of this is the creation of Woodrow Wilson. I don't think Wilson is terribly important here, except that he articulates very powerfully the need for America to be engaged in the world. He doesn't have much idea of organization. The 14 points say nothing, really, about organization, although they mention in the 14th point the notion of a general association of nations. Actually, the people who are really, really concerned about international organization are the British. Or to be even more precise about it, not the British, because the British in London are still very complacent about the safety of their empire. It's the Dominion's politicians, people like the man that I've written a bit about, Jan Smuts, the South African Prime Minister, who are terribly conscious about things that they call the yellow peril and the defense and the beleaguered position of the white races if there is not a permanent Anglo-American understanding. So how do you lock the Americans in to the safety of the defense of the British Empire? League of Nations. It's in that sense, and in Smuts's success in winning over an important section of the British Imperial War Cabinet, that you get the most powerful state in the world, the two most powerful states in the world, behind the idea of founding a world organization. Now, the League of Nations as the first permanent world organization is usually discussed under the sign of failure. Why do I think of 1919 as the key turning point and not, say, 1945? And of course, the League of Nations does fail, because the League of Nations is linked to the preservation of the Treaty of Versailles, but at the same time, the League of Nations fails to bring sufficient powers into it that will allow it to preserve that treaty. And so it fails in its primary purpose, which is an instrument of collective security in Europe. And it fails from another perspective, equally important to us today, it fails as an instrument of capitalist reconstruction in Europe. It has a little financial committee. I once wrote, the first book I wrote was on a very boring subject that nobody was interested in, Greek debt default, and in the interwar period. And the role of the League of Nations Financial Commission was absolutely instrumental. They were the people who, a bit like the Germans today, were basically trying to impose monetary discipline, free and independent central banks on as much of Europe as they could. And as they found out then, but as we've forgotten today, that isn't usually enough in the middle of a massively deflationary world crisis to save the show. But I'd place the stress as regards the League on what the League does achieve and see it as much more than just a kind of unfortunate precursor of a much improved United Nations. It's basically the start of the great era of global institutions. What do I mean? Firstly, that it provides the umbrella under which a large number of existing international organizations in the realm of labor organization or public health or scientific associations can band together and be protected and find new sources of funding and new ones as well. And many of these continue right through the interwar period into the post-war UN right up to the present day. It allows the power of scientific internationalism to persist. Secondly, the League represents, I would say, the most ambitious reliance on international law that we have ever seen, and I shall say a little bit about this in a moment, much more ambitious than you will find in the United Nations. In the form of things like the minority rights treaties, there is a commitment to make international law bite in the affairs of internal affairs of member states that the United Nations backs away from. Thirdly, it does put some colonies under international oversight. Of course, those are mostly the colonies of the defeated powers. But as regards the kind of logic of 19th century European imperialism, this is a major innovation. And as my colleague Susan Peterson has shown, and is showing in the work that she's now doing on the Permanent Mandates Commission, once you've set up that kind of body, you can't always control the results. And it encourages a kind of global participation beyond that too. India, China, Persia, Liberia are all founding members of the League of Nations, something that Metternich would not have understood at all. And above all, therefore, the League, through its existence, becomes symbolic of the possibility of real international cooperation based on the Mazzinian idea of a society of nation states. The League, in short, succeeds in making the idea of the United Nations possible. No League, no UN. Which raises, in turn, the question of what kind of turning point 1945 really was, the birth of the United Nations. It was Anglo-American cooperation in the war that had made the League possible, and it was renewed Anglo-American cooperation in the Second World War that allowed it to survive and to prosper in a revised form as something now called the United Nations Organization. But this time the roles were reversed. The British were in the back seat. Churchill, in particular, was deeply unenthusiastic about any kind of international organization because he was worried about the empire. And what we need, therefore, to explain is why the United States and its most powerful politicians, and particularly FDR, should have embraced the idea of membership of an international organization. Stalin, just to say something, Stalin goes along with this idea because he doesn't want to be left out. That's the short version of why the Soviet Union backs the United Nations. And they don't want to be left out. That's very, very important. But neither are they going to play a major role in it or attach it much weight. And they're going to throw around the Soviet veto in the UN quite liberally in the early years, whereas the Americans will be very, very proud that they never used the veto in the 1940s. So why? Why is there a rethink in Washington? I think, again, for strategic reasons, that the interwar experience, and Pearl Harbor in particular, has demonstrated on solid military grounds, this time America has to be in, come what may, for the duration, for the sake of American military security. And given the American public's abhorrence of permanent alliances, and nothing had changed there, I think, this could not be called the League of Nations and would necessitate a new vehicle. And that vehicle was to become, or was to be, the UN. It could be based on the League. It couldn't say that it was based on the League. And it must be different, sufficiently different from the League to guarantee success. The British, whether they were unenthusiastic about this idea, like Churchill, or rather more enthusiastic, like Eden, they would do whatever it took to help this along, understanding the pressures from Congress and a skeptical public. And so here's an interesting document from May 42 that Eden pens when he's presented with the State Department proposal for what would become the first UN agency, UNRWA, one of the first. Eden writes, early in this partnership, "It must be obvious that for the sake of any post-war relief scheme, the contribution of the US will be all important. But I fancy that there is much more than post-war relief in question. The US administration appears to be acting on the thesis that the more international machinery that can be got into operation with their participation before the end of the war, the greater the likelihood of American public opinion, that's always the great anxiety, being ready to continue with international cooperation after the war. It would perhaps be putting it too high at this stage to say the administration definitely intends to try and establish, under the aegis of the United Nations, the embryo of the international organization of the future. American post-war cooperation in the international sphere being so vitally important, I submit we must play up to any scheme of theirs tending to turn the United Nations into an operative piece of machinery." By early 44, this was no longer in doubt. The former League of Nations Association, the League Boosters in America, had obligingly changed their name in order to publicize the United Nations. Otherwise, they were exactly the same guys running it, and the battle for public opinion was joined. So how should this new League of Nations differ from the old? A new international vehicle had to provide the maximum opportunities for American power with a minimum of restraints, and hence the return to a kind of great power conception of international government that was most visible with the veto of the permanent members of the Security Council. Unlike the League, there would be much less of an appeal to a supra-political vision of international law, because America, alongside the Soviet Union, was now the world power. And when you're the world power, as the British had been in the 19th century, you dislike being bound by anything, because you think you don't need to be. And that goes for international law. It's always the second-ranking power, or the first-ranking power, feeling it's on the way down, that will embrace the idea of normative constraint. So the international lawyers could be encouraged, but they were to be kept in their place. And we could have a conversation about what the real meaning of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was from that point of view, or indeed of the Genocide Convention, with what its architect regarded as its key central clauses ripped out of it before it was passed. So there's a rolling back of the League's experiment in international law, marking the emergence of a new realist mindset, both amongst the UN's critics and amongst its supporters. There was a temporary easing off of American anti-imperialism for the sake of the alliance with the British, but only a temporary one. Once the Russians started playing the anti-colonial card, and once the American Navy had its bases in the Pacific, then the US would follow down the path of anti-colonialism. There was what you might call a New Deal conception of security that was very different from that of the League. Security would come not through public opinion, but rather through strategic planning, through willingness to use force in defense of the UN goals. A military staff was envisaged for the UN, it was still born, and through New Deal planning in economic affairs as well. At the same time, and this is, I think, where a lot of histories of the UN perhaps get it slightly wrong, the UN was never going to be at the center of American foreign policy. And that's completely understandable if you accept my basic point that the real purpose of the UN was to lock American public opinion into a peacetime role in policing the globe. Once that had been achieved, it didn't really matter what you did with the UN or not, provided it endured. And in fact, the reconstruction of Europe, which had initially been planned to happen under the aegis of the UN, once Truman comes into power, is shifted away from the UN, and entirely new institutions like the Marshall Plan are set up so that the reconstruction of Europe and European capitalism can be run by Washington unilaterally. And so the period of 45 to 1950 is a period where a lot of the supporters of world government in America in the war go two ways. Some of them get bitterly disillusioned. They think the US has sold out. Some of them go the other way. I'm thinking of the man who is a youthful president of the United World Federalists when the war ends, Cord Meyer, who, as you may know, rises to a very prominent position in the CIA in the 1960s, because he comes to the conclusion that his wartime vision of internationalism is impossible when America is under threat from global communism. From the 1950s onwards, there is a turn outwards, a turn to the globe, and this is a new lease of life for the UN, because the UN now has a new and enhanced role to play for American foreign policy. They're unified by shared anti-colonialism, and the US and the new international agencies find they can help one another. Doug Hammarskjöld is a key figure here. Andrew Cordier of Colombia is another. But this really goes well beyond individuals. You find all sorts of agencies that have been created to deal with the situation in Europe, like the World Bank, being retooled in the early 1950s to become what they are today. In the World Bank's case, a global development agency. The US is in the lead on almost all of these counts, because it's confident of its built-in majority in many issues on the General Assembly, so confident that it takes the initiative that is incomprehensible to us today to try to shift power in the UN from the Security Council to the General Assembly through the 1950s. At the same time, one starts to see the strains on the UN system itself. There's a kind of overloading, duplication. There's the question of who's really governing what. Is there any kind of government involved here at all? The most acid assessment of this comes from a man who was possibly the most brilliant administrator in the entire Second World War, an Australian called Robert Jackson, who is asked in 1969 to report on the capacity of the United Nations. His report, and you wouldn't normally get this kind of language in an administrative report, opens like this. Who controls this machine? So far, the evidence suggests that governments do not, and also that the machine as a whole has become unmanageable in the strictest sense of the word. It's becoming slower and more unwieldy, like some prehistoric monster. And it's at this point that if you're the historian, the study of international government unfortunately becomes a study of endless acronyms and bureaucracies, whereas in the 1850s it had all been about kind of crazed utopians and visionaries. Now it's about committees and subcommittees and committees of subcommittees and so on. And that's a problem for the author, but it's also a symptom of something that's happening, of consolidation of the idea of international government, of normalization, but maybe of disintegration as well. And so briefly, we come to my final phase, the phase of disintegration from 1975 until now. In keeping with the hypothesis that I put to you here, that you can't separate ideas and the institutionalization of ideas about governing the world from real power, what you have to ask is, why did attitudes change? And why did attitudes change in Washington, whose support had been instrumental for building up the whole system and making the idea of international government effective in ways that Metternich could never have understood? Washington had believed in the 1940s that history was on its side in two respects: the spread of national self-determination and the transformation of modern capitalism. And it designed international organizations that would facilitate those two trends. But then what happened in the 1960s? Internally to the world of the UN and international organizations, the United Nations' historic mission, which was a real one, as globalization, globalizer of the Mazzinian idea of national self-determination, more or less comes to an end. The empires are decolonizing. By the early 1970s, there's well over 150 members of the UN. In 1945, there'd been less than 50. And decolonization has happened, and it's changed the character of the General Assembly. Far from consolidating pro-American feeling, it erodes it. There are also calls from these new members for a new international economic order. In other words, a recalibration of modern capitalism, not along the lines that Washington had in mind. And that put the UN and the United States on a kind of collision course. And one would have to also mention Israel after 1967, maybe the single issue that drives a wedge between the United States and the newly decolonized members of the General Assembly. But actually, I think the major causes of the disillusionment, not to be too Marxist about it, lie outside the realm of these international organizations altogether, in shifts in the nature of post-war capitalism and their institutional consequences. There's a brilliant book by a policy theorist called Alistair Roberts called The Logic of Discipline, in which he studies how the Thatcher and Reagan revolution transformed state institutions from the late 70s onwards. And this is mostly focused on domestic state institutions, away from parliaments and ministries to semi-autonomous agencies like central banks, regulatory agencies, or public-private legislated reliance on things like credit ratings agencies. The kind of institutions that could help along what was happening at that time, which was this historically unprecedented globalization of trade, but even more important, we would now see globalization of finance capital. And all of this had a huge impact on domestic institutions and on international institutions, and probably more of an impact on international institutions who did not have electorates to support them. This was contemporaneous with a semantic shift. People stopped talking about government and start talking about governance, a very interesting and important shift that we could go into that I think also bespeaks an ebbing of confidence in the capacity of states and policymakers to be trusted to do the right thing. Does the rise of the International Criminal Court, and here I'm going to be very schematic and wrap up, does the rise of the International Criminal Court, of the Genocide Convention in the 1990s, of human rights movements from the late 70s onwards, does that argue against this view for a kind of continued vitality of the internationalist impulse? A lot of people have said so. Perhaps it does, but in a very different vein to that I've articulated for the middle of the 20th century, and much more of a kind of return to the anti-institutionalist thinking about internationalism of the mid-19th. Human rights activists, indeed the ICC, basically see states and their rulers as the problem and have come to rely to an ever-increasing extent on NGOs, on some kind of putative civil society as an ally in this struggle. The new doctrine of humanitarian intervention, of responsibility to protect, suggested a forceful new role for international organizations, but also have opened them up to criticism. For instance, the criticism from Africans that all of the figures who've been arraigned before the ICC are in fact African. Similar anti-institutionalism was visible in the political theories that were being advanced in the early 2000s. I'm thinking, for instance, of the book by somebody who then headed the policy planning staff in the Obama administration, Anne-Marie Slaughter of Princeton, in her New World Order, who argues that, in fact, we have a New World Order. It's just not one of the UN and formal institutions, but of transgovernmental agencies and networks interacting with one another and with corporations and professional circles as well. Maybe so, but look at the difference between that view and the free trade global ideologues of the 19th century. They were optimists about mass rationality, and they saw the problem before them as the unrepresentative character of autocratic elites. The New World Order view reflects Robert's logic of discipline. It's faithful to the rationality of elites to spread things that we now call best practice or good governance, because parliaments and electorates are likely to mess them up or to ignore them because they're seen as fora for the arbitration of special interests and lobbies. So parliaments and democracy become exercises in irrationality. There's something, in other words, deeply skeptical about, in this reading, about the very democratic institutions that 19th century internationalists saw as the prerequisite for world peace and social harmony. And now, after 2008, 2010 perhaps, where does this deinstitutionalization and perhaps too the slow waning of American power leave the idea of governing the world? It hardly needs saying, on the day that the chief economist of the OECD, and there's no better model of a 1940 style international institution than that, calls urgently for forceful policy action, that there was something very Pollyanna-ish, I think, about those New World Order ideas so prevalent in the 1990s and early 2000s that we should all just sit back and enjoy the best practice and good governance that comes naturally from experts and civil servants doing their thing in a global market. Were the ratings agencies just doing their thing? Are central bankers just doing their thing now? It's crises, the interwar slump, the Second World War, that expose institutional weaknesses, and the crisis of capital, like the earlier crisis of global warming, suggests we've paid a heavy price for the retreat from institutions. The question in my mind is whether we've also lost the belief and the will to find the ideas and the institutional creativity that formed the basis of the story I've outlined so schematically here. Thank you very much.
Professor Mazower has agreed to answer some questions, and there's a microphone in both aisles. So if you would, if you have a question, it would step there. We'll wait a moment. There we are.
Thank you for your talk. I don't think I heard you mention the transformation of the GATT process into the permanent World Trade Organization as a complicating counterexample to your deinstitutionalization theory. I wonder if you see it as that or how you see that fitting in.
Thank you. I think that it's very important. I think that what happened from the mid-1980s onwards with the Washington Consensus was that effective international governance was more and more narrowed down to what are maybe misleadingly known as the Bretton Woods institutions, the IMF and the World Bank and then GATT and later the World Trade Organization. And these were asked to play a very important role. So in a sense, what I'm arguing is that a general deinstitutionalization is perfectly compatible with the emergence of some institutions which are regarded, in this case internationally, as being important at that moment for the guarantee or the transformation or the protection of this new international economic order that's coming into being. And I think they were seen as playing this very important role. And so was the pushing of a free trade campaign that led to the emergence of the World Trade Organization. Everything that I've read, I'm not an expert about it, about the World Trade Organization ever since, well, everything I've read about all three organizations actually suggests that one of the consequences of the current crisis was that their own capacity and utility in all of this has been thrown deeply into question. And they were being marginalized by the mid-2000s in a way that they had not anticipated. Clients were fleeing the IMF and the World Bank, and the World Trade Organization was stuck in a kind of paralysis from which it hasn't emerged. So I don't think that it's a counterexample, but I agree that these three institutions emerge in the 1990s in an environment in which they are seen as being particularly useful for global capitalism, and the others are discarded. I mean, the UNDP and the UNEP and so forth are simply pushed to one side.
Could you address briefly how the EU fits into your view? I mean, I suppose one could say the EU is increasingly institutionalized power center during the period of the end of the 20th century. So I wonder if you can address that.
Yeah. Well, there was an alternative ending to my talk in which I speculated about the irony of a story that begins in Europe in the early 19th century, ending in Europe in the early 21st century. And that must be some sense of that the European Union is in some ways the most ambitious venture anywhere in international governance. Is now on the front line of this clash, as I see it, between international finance capital and institutions. And that's the significance of the battle, in short. So what started out as it were, an adjunct in the American empire in the late 1940s as one of a number of regional configurations, and then took on a life of its own, really. I mean, what then developed in the 1960s onwards was the result of European initiatives more than American initiatives, is now facing a kind of crisis of confidence that's going to be a sort of test for much less robust international institutions as well. So I think it's part of the story and very important.
Yes.
I was just wondering what you think of the forces now in place trying to keep the peace in, say, places like Kosovo, with UNMIC and that sort of thing. I mean, where do you see that going in the near future?
Kosovo is a very complicated question. The history of Balkan independence movements could be written in two ways, and one as the kind of people throwing off tyranny for themselves, starting with the Serbs and the Greeks in the early 19th century and coming up to the Kosovans now. And the other is of astute tail-wagging the dog management of the international system, in which a relatively small number of nationalist revolutionaries take advantage of balance of power in order to bring much more powerful sponsors, great power sponsors, in on their side. I was very much in favor, I'm not sure this is an answer to your question, but I'll go ahead anyway. I mean, I was very much in favor of intervention in Bosnia. I thought the issues there were very clear-cut. I was much less in favor of intervention in Kosovo for all kinds of reasons. And one of them was that it was not at all clear what you were going to create in the aftermath of this, and you were going to end up with a situation of basically running a protectorate for a very long time. So it was not a situation that I personally supported in 1999 at all. But this has become, you know, and these kinds of rather episodic campaigns have become enormously important for the whole UN machine. I mean, they occupy enormous amounts of time of the Secretary General in the UN. I have no answer to what should happen.
Mark, may I ask you a final question? Will Greece default? Will Greek democracy survive? And will the euro come out of this crisis strengthened or in a state of utter collapse?
People charge thousands of dollars for this kind of advice. And I never give it because I don't know. I do not think that Greek democracy is in jeopardy in any way because people remember have vivid memories of the military dictatorship that only ended in 1974. When you've been through something like that, you don't want to go back to it, especially when you remember how economically incompetent the colonels were. Will Greece default? Well, Greece is effectively in default. Will they leave the euro? I don't know. I would have said until last week that I thought they should try everything possible to stay in. I think I'm moving towards the position now where I think it might make a certain kind of sense for them to quit. And then what the future of the euro is after that, it all depends on the Germans. And I'm not an expert on the Germans, but so far it's been disappointing.
Thank you very much for a stimulating talk and wonderful answers to the questions.